morning. How is everyone today? It's such a quiet morning. I think it's because my children aren't here. Isabella had a little bit of a sore throat. I'm going to keep my distance from all of you today, so you could pray for her. But we're so glad that all of you are here this morning. And we live in a place where we can stand and we can believe firmly in our God and we can praise Him. And that is something to give praise for, just that. And we have so many other things to give praise for and to be thankful for. So let's stand and let's praise the Lord together this morning.
Praise the name that makes the way. There's nothing that our God can do. Oh. Let all your sins. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise. Let all agree. There's no power like His power. There's nothing that our God can do. There's not a mountain that He can move. Oh, praise the name that makes no way. There's nothing that our God can do. Sing it out. There's nothing that our God can do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes the way. There's nothing that our God can do. Oh, 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 oh. There's nothing, there's nothing, there's nothing. Oh,
even when I don't feel it. you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are here, Waymaker. I worship you. You're like summer in the night. The sun goes down, but still I feel you. Every shadow's turning bright. Every broken heart is made new. You're not far away. Coming close. Oh, even as I wait, you're coming close.
coming close. You're like starlight in the dark. Endless miles can't conceal you. Every glimmer is a spark, catching fire as you break through.
Experts are telling us that one of the things that is increasing these days is the anxiety related to the fear that you're alone. It's not like there's been a change in the number of people who are around us, but there's this issue where we feel isolated and alone because those who are around us are either as anxious as we are or worse. We all look for someone who can walk along with us that will be our champion. And I hope you know that for me, each day I have that sense of helplessness and woe. When you think about all the complicated circumstances that surround us these days, it would be easy to lose our focus and become fearful. But I've always known since I was a little boy that I never walked alone. That I had this power that surrounded me. No, not the force. And this power that surrounded me, that watched over me, that walked with me, that walked through everything for me. And that power is Christ. Hebrews chapter 2 reminds us of this particular truth. It says, for this reason he had to be made like them. Talking about Jesus here. Fully human in every way, in order that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in service to God. And that he might make atonement for the sins of the people. Because he himself suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. The temptation contextually here is the temptation to be afraid, especially to be afraid of death. We'll dig into this here in just a little bit more in the sermon, but it says here that he's our merciful and faithful high priest. It was the job of the high priest once a year to go into the Holy of Holies, and make the sacrifice for the children and for their sins. Jesus decided to do that a different way. He emptied himself of heaven, came to this earth, took on human likeness, suffered like we are, so not only would he make atonement for our sin, but he could be familiar with our suffering. Which uniquely qualifies him then not just to be our high priest, but to also to be the one who comes and helps us. We need to be the kinds of folks that will help people find atonement through Christ, but also be his agents of help. And that's what we've been talking about here recently. Because he himself suffered, Jesus, when he was tempted, he is able to help those or being tempted to be afraid. As I said, there are a lot of folks who are out there fearful these days. They're looking for heroes. Sometimes they're looking to politicians, unfortunately. Other times they're looking to people who seem to be powerful or influential or famous or excellent at something that they do, only to find out later that these people are fearful as well. There's only one, who can really help us when we are facing fear, and that is Jesus. Because he deals with the ultimate scourge of fear, and that is death. That's why when we gather around the table symbolically and we partake of the emblems today, the cup with the juice and the cup with the bread underneath, it is a reminder to us of his sacrifice. The broken bread is the sacrifice of his body. He gave it willingly. The cup of juice represents his shed blood, which forgives us of our sins. And this significant event in history is to be celebrated by us as often as we do it when we gather together, to remind us that no matter how things might look out there in the world, we don't have to be afraid. We can hold our head up high, and we can look with faith to the journey that God has before us. It might look dark. It might not be what we would want it to be. It might not be the way that we would write the story. But we can have faith and trust that God is with us, and he'll walk with us through it. Let's pray. Fathers, we partake of these emblems today, this cup with the little pieces of broken bread in it, representing your sacrifice of your body, reminding us that we can face any temptation or any fear and we can overcome because you did. And the cup of juice, which represents your shed blood, that deals with the issue of our fear connected to death, and that is the judgment that follows and the forgiveness that we have through your Son Christ and his atonement, gives us confidence when we will face you on that day of judgment, because we know we'll stand before you cleansed, perfect in his blood, even if we might not be perfect in our behavior. It's important, Lord, for us to take time to remember that today, to celebrate that today. So in these few minutes where we are inspired by music and we partake, help us to look fear right in the eyes and say, get behind me, because I have Jesus. And we pray this in his name. He was taking a class, training class, on how to help Austin when he transfers back home. They have to learn some medical things, and so he was not able to be here to do the communion. So pray for Austin and all the family as they make that transition. Roxanne asked us to remember Brenda Shar. She had emergency surgery last week, and then she's got to see a specialist in Indianapolis because her intestine was crushed in the car accident last week. So be in prayer for her as she's having to heal from that. And of course, Randy as well. Also pray for Roxanne tomorrow, or tomorrow morning. She goes over to Springfield to have surgery on her knee. So pray for her as she has that work done. I'm going to go over a little bit later on this afternoon and pray with her and her family. So just lift them all up in prayer for that. And we appreciate that and your thoughtfulness in those areas. Well, what do you want to do today? All right. We had a chronic, I think that I was going to say, what was the name of the guy in Chitty Chitty Bang Bang that came and stole all the kids? You remember that guy? I hated that guy, too. Dallas is our only grade schooler today, I think. So we were all prepared, but we had a little batch of sore throats at our house, and then we've had other folks just say that they were not going to be able today, so we're sorry for that, but we'll try to make this interesting for all of you as we talk about fear. Today we want to continue in our discussion, conversation about compassionate care for the soul. We have been talking about how important it is for us to minister to those who are suffering. I had a conversation with a young man the other day, and he is, he would be, you know, somewhat late 30s, early 40s. We were talking about us just picking his brain about his generation and what it was about church and things like that that was not as interesting to them as it might have been to generations before. And I was surprised by what he said. He said, well, one of the things is that it just seems to be too changeable, and that the way he put it was that it's always changing in a way that you don't have any confidence in it. And I said, well, maybe it's the fact that the church doesn't have confidence, and so it's always changing. So we had a little discussion about that, and we got into this thing about the fundamental aspect of the church. I said, well, what do you think the main goal of the church should always be? And he said, to always love and care for people. And whatever form that that takes, that needs to be the most important thing that churches do. And that's what we've been talking about here for the last 6 weeks, 5 weeks here, about how we can really care for people, especially with the unique situation we find ourselves in with the pandemic of 2020. Now, none of us want to go through what we've gone through, but here's the news, bad news, good news, however you want to think of it. We still got to go through what we got to go through to get to the other side. We're not there yet, right? So we've been talking about how we can be like Jesus, who was our man of sorrows, who was familiar with suffering, and also a great physician, and become his good Samaritan team to minister to those that we find who are hurting as we come across them, as the good Samaritan did with the man on the side of the road who'd been robbed. So we have been talking about being a part of that team, God's trauma team, but we have to recognize the effects of trauma so that we know how to minister to it. So last week we started talking about that. We introduced the idea of the traumatic effects, and we saw a chart that showed some of the things that might be an indicator of trauma. We talked about shame and grief as the primary things that trauma creates in people's lives, and how we can help people through their shame and how we can help them through their grief. And over the next three Sundays, we're going to talk about the three areas which Diane Langberg, and she's a counselor, a Christian counselor, who's been helping people through trauma for 40 years, she identifies as main things that we need to address, stress. One is fear. We'll talk about that today. Next week, we'll talk about frustration. And then last week in October, we'll be talking about faithfulness. And faithfulness is that thought that, everything's falling apart. You know, nothing good will ever happen ever again. So today, as we talk about traumatic fear, the effects of trauma in our life, one of the things that is often seen is fear as a product of trauma. And when you're afraid of things, it can cause so much anxiety and struggle within us that we don't want to do anything. We cease trying. We don't want to be involved. We don't want to engage because we are just afraid everything's going to fall apart. And we're living in a day and age when I never thought we would see this, but we live in a day and an age where we are afraid to be around other people, especially if we feel like they might be compromised with their immunity. We're afraid to be around other people and engage with them because of what might happen. And regardless of where you might get your information as far as the statistics on the pandemic and the morbidity rates and the infection rates and things like that, we've now had enough time to try to look at it from a clear perspective. And as Christians, we have a great opportunity to help those who are living in fear to have some freedom from it, and to gain the perspective that they can be still be fulfilled in life even though we are struggling through this. And then also, what's really important is that with all the concerns that we have about finances these days, that God still promises that He's going to fund our lives so that we can still do the things that we need to do. We can have shelter, we can eat, we can even enjoy the things that we have in life. And so we want to talk about each of those things today, how we as believers can help those that we know overcome their fear by reminding them of the freedom they have in Christ, the fulfillment that they have in Him, but also how God always promises to fund our lives as if we put our faith and our trust in Him. The president was sick last week. He was put into the hospital. And you know, I don't like to talk about politics here because it's really not the place for us to do that. But when he became ill, it illustrated for us the great divide that we have in our country about this illness. There's a lot of fear that exists in this country because when some people heard that the president of the United States had tested positive for COVID, they immediately thought he was going to die. Why would they think that? Well, because they've been told for the last 4 or 5 months that if you get the COVID, you don't have any other choice but to die. So whenever he came out of the hospital a few days later and he stood there on the balcony, it seemed to make some people mad that he somehow survived. Now, there might have been a number of reasons for that. They might not have been for him politically, or it might have been that it just didn't fit into their narrative about the fear that we should have about this particular disease. Because as they said, if there was anyone who would die from this COVID infection, it would be someone who's obesely, or is morbidly obese, as they kept calling our president, and old like he is. What is he, 74 or something like that? What we were seeing was that about half the country, maybe not half, but there are a lot of people in this country who use death and disease and debilitation. And we had immediately they started talking about the 25th Amendment, where the president would be debilitated. He wouldn't be able to fulfill his duties. I think Nancy Pelosi even introduced some kind of bill this last week to deal with this particular issue. He wouldn't be able to do what he wanted to do. I think it's funny that the third person in line is introducing a bill that would put her one step closer to being the most powerful person in the world. But whether you're cynical like me and you think a lot of this is promoted to exploit is for sinister purposes, or you just may be very, very trusting and think, well, these people, they really just do care. And wherever you find yourself in that, please know that this issue of death and disease and debilitation surrounding the issue of the COVID pandemic is being used by some to keep us living in fear. Diane Langberg, as I mentioned, she's a counselor who's been working with people in trauma for 40 years. She works with people who've been abused, those who have survived mass genocide. She's helped people who have lost everything in natural disasters. I mean, she's covered all the bases when it comes to the treatment of those who've gone through trauma. She says this about the pandemic. She says the pandemic has exposed and escalated other crises. Comforting death or confronting death, living isolated lives, and experiencing continual fear has significantly increased the level of trauma. Depression, suicide, addictions, and post-traumatic stress disorder have multiplied. Our mental health systems are not prepared for this onslaught. Economic losses will only exacerbate these problems, even if the pandemic ends and a vaccine helps prevent its return. Mental health crises will likely continue for years, she says. There was a Good Samaritan walking down the side of a road when he saw someone who had been beaten and robbed and left for dead. He didn't cross to the other side of the road. He walked right up to that person who was hurting. He offered them help and then made sure that they had the process for healing. So how can we help? When we find those people who are beaten and left for dead on the side of the road, they're exposed, they're hurting. And again, you can go back and listen to any of the sermons or watch any of the sermons on our YouTube, or you can find all those things on our website as well, palcc.org. But we dug deeply into who are we to be helping, who is our neighbor, and the answer to that is anyone we find who's really struggling. And if we have a lot of folks who are going through a mental health crisis because they are fearful in their lives to live because of the fear of death or disease or debilitation, we have a great ministry opportunity because, as we talked about during communion, we have one who helps us overcome our fear. And that's our Savior, Christ Jesus. The most helpful things we can offer to those in distress around us is the truth about fear. Psalms 27, verse 1 says this, "The Lord is my light and my salvation." You know how it continues? Well, it says it right there in your bulletin. You could say it out loud. Say it. "Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" The Bible is very clear that when we are facing whatever situation, and I know that as we're going through what we're going through right now, we think it's pretty bad, but comparatively with some of the other things that that nations have gone through, disease, sickness, genocide, pandemics, things like that, what we've gone through is fairly mild, and mainly because of the ability that we have to address the issue. But even though we're able to address the issue quickly and with historical speed, still, you're going to find people who are out there that saying, blaming that deaths and the disease is the fault of someone else. Should we be a part of that? Or should we offer comfort, courage, and confidence to those who are incapacitated by fear because things have been amplified by the events of 2020? I think it's important for us not to be like those in the world. And, you know, this is where I want to encourage you that when you are having political conversations with people, remember to always have gentleness and respect in your heart. And remember that the reason we have any conversation with anyone is to talk to them about the love of Christ and why we believe in Him and why we think He can help us through this particular situation. But I think we should offer comfort, courage, and confidence instead of contribute to the fear that people have of the death and disease and debilitation that comes from it. So today we want to talk about those three ways we can do that. First of all, let's talk about how we can comfort those who fear death with the truth, comforting truth about death. And the reality that we need to live in is that when it comes to death, we have freedom. We are not enslaved to the fear of death. Even if we are sick, even if someone says we are going to die, we still should not be afraid. I was reading from Hebrews 2. Let me read verse 14 for you. Following, it says, "Since the children have flesh and blood, he too shared in the humanity, so that by his death he might break the power of him who holds the power of death, that is, the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death." And then I read the rest of for you during the communion time. Jesus came, he shared in our humanity, he rose from the dead, he beat death, so that we can break the power of the devil who holds us in fear of death. He holds us as slaves to that. And why does that matter? Because if you're always afraid that you're going to die, then you'll never live. And in this world, we could give 100 illustrations just right off the top of our heads of how people have told us that you can't contract this disease. You need to be careful because if you get it, you're going to surely die. So it has changed the whole way that we approach life. And some people are still afraid to even get out there and live, work, do whatever they need to do, because they're afraid ultimately that if they get the disease, they will die. Now, I'm not trying to underplay. It's not a good thing to have, but as we're learning more and more about it, we should be more fearful of other things than the coronavirus. It's anticipated more people are going to die from the flu this year. And so you can go get a flu shot, but we've gotten to the point where we're just used to, well, if we get the flu, we need to take care of ourselves. We need to address it. Most people will get through it unless there's some other issue that is involved. But fearing death holds us hostage to whatever scheme the devil might have that he's using at that particular time in history to just make people afraid to live. Because if we're afraid to live, then we're afraid to engage. If we're afraid to engage, then we're not connecting with those people who are around us. If we're not connecting with those people around us, we cannot share with them the truth of God's word. We can't even set the example of our courage and confidence. And the devil's been using different schemes since the time of Christ to hold us in fear to death. There's always going to be some issue. We might get past the coronavirus, maybe 4 years from now, we won't even think about it anymore. But there's going to be something else that will be on the forefront of the newspaper and everybody's minds that says you should be afraid to live. And I'm telling you as your friend and as someone who's trying to help you understand what the Bible says, don't ever be afraid to live because you're not afraid to die. And the reason we're not afraid to die is because we know the one who holds for us what happens to us in death, and that is Christ Jesus, our Savior. It's a win-win for us, like Paul, to live as Christ and to die as gain. We don't have to worry about that. I don't want anyone to ever get sick. I don't want anyone to ever suffer. I don't want anyone to ever die. But listen, we've had all those things with us from the beginning of time. And God wants us to live in freedom. Not just me. I mean, now experts are starting to point out that these are important things for us to do. As a matter of fact, according to the ADAA, which is the Anxiety and Depression Association of America, I think, they released this thing about the top 10 things we need to look at now. And if you'll bring that up, scroll down for me there to number 2. Says, do not engage in worry. And then scroll on down to number three. Focus on the present odds. Now listen to this. All deaths are tragic, but we must maintain proper perspective. The mass majority of people infected with COVID-19 have mild to moderate symptoms or no symptoms at all. And the mortality rate, if you do contract the virus, ranges from 1.4% to 3%. The exact mortality rate is unknown at this time. The number of deaths will continue to climb, and the news will report everyone, and yet the chance of you or a loved one dying is still remote, especially with everyone's effort to maintain distance and isolate. But death is possible, and it's why anxious people take the bait and dwell. Possibility becomes probability. So remind yourself of the present odds, which are very good. After all, if you went to Vegas and it had a 97% chance of winning, you'd be excited to take those odds. If you take care of yourself properly, even if you are in a higher risk category, your risk of death is still so low. So instead of living in fear of death, live in fear of the odds of life. And for some people, they go, oh man, now I got to really face life. You know, I've been distracted by fear of death all this time, and now I got to think that I'm going to make it and I got to live through all this. The comforting truth about death is we have freedom over it no matter what happens. We don't have to dwell in it. We don't have to worry about it. But especially with this particular pandemic that we're living, now even mental experts are saying the chances are so remote. Don't fixate on them. No matter how many news stories or how many people around you or whomever might say, yeah, but it could kill you. I think I saw some statistic that you're more likely to be killed in a riot than by the pandemic. And yet people go out there and voluntarily get into those types of things. So the comforting truth about death is we have freedom. Don't let the devil lie to you, because that's what he wants to do, is keep you enslaved to that fear. Number two, courageous truth about disease. Share with folks the courageous truth about disease. The thing that we need to know about any type of sickness is that we fear it because we think it somehow is going to take things away from us. And we'll talk about debilitation here in just a second, but I'm talking about it from the standpoint of the fear of we're being punished somehow because we're going through this. I mean, have you ever been sick with the flu? I mean, just really super sick, and your throat's, you know, raw, and your head's stuffed up, and you've been sweating for days, and you cannot sleep, and you say, why me, Lord? And we think we might have done something. We go through our mind, well, did I eat after someone? Did I do something that caused me to contract this horrible thing? And we go through that whole process and we just feel miserable about it. Or we might think that we're being punished for something we've done. And here's the thing about disease is that God does not want us to live in fear when it comes to do with that idea of punishment. And so many people have attached the idea of punishment to this disease. First John chapter 4, verse 17 through 18 says, this is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. In this world we are like Jesus. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. Now the reason I share this verse with you is this part. Perfect love drives out fear. There's no fear in love, because fear has to do with punishment. Why did so many people want us to be afraid of this pandemic? And why do you think it's causing such anxiety and stress in the people that you know? Because it's being used as a weapon to punish us, so that we can punish each other. And it's become so horrible that, you know, we are using words like hate. You know, the memes that are out there about you hate my grandmother if you don't wear a mask type thing. And we're using it to, in politically, to create one of the most, well, I shouldn't say the most, because if you look historically, it gets pretty bad around election time, but one of the most difficult times for us to all go through, where there's just a lot of fear because people are saying they're blaming, and blaming has to do with punishment, and it has to do with, doesn't have anything to do with perfect fear, but it has to do with hate. But here's the thing about us in Christ is we live in His perfect fear. We do not have to be afraid because perfect love drives out fear, and we're to live in that, not just when we look forward to heaven when we stand before the Lord, but we can live in that perfect fear every day. We can be made perfect in love. And that drives away the fear. And we can follow that example because Jesus was in this world and He lived that way. How many people hated Jesus when He was on this earth? Just about everybody but His disciples and His followers, which didn't amount to very many people. The government hated Him. Religious people hated Him. Some in His family, they didn't like what He was doing. They took Him to task. But Jesus always demonstrated love because He was never afraid of punishment. Courageous truth about disease is that we are fulfilled by Christ Jesus in His perfect love. And we should never fall prey to these arguments about punishment or who's doing wrong or who's to blame. That's a specious argument to get into. The truth of the matter is that if we have love for one another, perfect love will drive out any fear we have, and we will not blame each other for that. Because blame's not the point. Salvation is the point. Forgiveness is the point. Grace is the point. If God wanted punishment to be the point when we stand before Him on Judgment Day, then He wouldn't even have Christ as an option and His love and forgiveness to be a part of that. So be courageous. I mentioned President Trump earlier, and you can go ahead and get this ready to go. Again, I want you just to listen to what he says after he got out of the hospital. Go ahead and start that up, Alan.
I just left Walter Reed Medical Center, and it's really something very special. The doctors, the nurses, the first responders, and I learned so much about coronavirus. And one thing that's for certain, don't let it dominate you. Don't be afraid of it. You're going to beat it. We have the best medical equipment. We have the best medicines, all developed recently.
And you can all right, beat that's it. Good. I didn't feel so don't bad. Let coronavirus dominate you. Now, do you think, let me ask you this question. Do you think maybe when he was told he had the virus, he might have had just a little moment of fear? All the things he'd been told about that if you're that age and you are overweight and you get the virus, you're going to die. Think he might have had just a little bit of fear? It's possible. But he survived, he overcame, and here's what he said. He said, don't let coronavirus dominate you. Don't be afraid of it. And I thought it was pretty interesting that he would make that announcement and he came out. But he was trying to break some confidence and comfort to the country because we had been harassed for 3 days over the weekend that we may have to install a new president, or we have to invoke the 25th Amendment, or we may have to go have a funeral and all these different things. But there was no love in that. When you're helping people who are afraid because they are afraid of the disease, remind them that even if they do have the disease, they can be overcomers, not to be afraid, not to let hate be a part of that, but just let love, let perfect love drive out that fear, and only Christ can do that for us. And then here, number three, confident truth, offer the confident truth about debilitation. Now, this is a little more tricky because God says that He provides. He's the creator of the world, so He is providential in that Everything that we see in this world, he has provided for us to take advantage of. But then we have the added benefit of being his children, in which he promises he will bless us and he'll take care of us in every incredible way. And many of us believe that, because when we walked into the building this morning, the first thing we did was we put stuff on our hands, what we call sanitizer in our hands. Then we put our offering in the offering plate, and when we put our offering in the offering plate, that is a demonstration of faith and trust in God that he's going to take care of us, right? Amen? But there are so many people who are afraid that even if they have survived and they have their jobs, they're going to be losing their jobs. So debilitation has become one of those things that the world is afraid of. Fearing debilitation hampers folks' confidence in God's provision. And I think that's one of the big tricks that the devil is using right now. And one of the things that we see as a part of the lack of church attendance, that it's dropped off by 50-60% in most churches, and that pretty much holds true around the country. The churches are just not, people are just not getting back for whatever reason. And I would say the first thing, because of the way I was brought up, the first thing I would do when the doors were open was be in there offering my gifts to the Lord, because I know that he is the giver of all good things. But the world doesn't think like that. But what we can remind people of is that they can be confident, even if they're afraid that they might not have a job and not be able to make it through. As a matter of fact, Hebrews chapter 13, verses 5 through 6 says, "Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, 'Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you.' So say with confidence, 'The Lord is my helper, I am not afraid. What can mere mortals do to me?'" And the context here is money, funds. God's not going to leave us behind just because there's a pandemic. And I know that there are people hurting, and I know that there are folks who've lost their jobs, and I know that there are all kinds of issues that are going on, but there'll be a resolution of that at some point, and there's been help to support folks through that. But the thing that they can never overcome, if they don't overcome it now, is the fear of constant debilitation, because there'll always be some threat to our ability to make money and to provide. But not, you will never be afraid if you trust the Lord with all your heart. And you know that he's your helper and he will never leave you. He will never forsake you. So don't be afraid. It doesn't matter what's going on in the world. God will take care of you, period. Give people some confidence. Remind them of the facts. Here in Dark County, I'm going to have Alan put up that another website for you. In Dark County, you can look at our unemployment rate. Can you go down? You'll have to go, yeah, there you go. Look at our, it's not seasonally judges, but the rate right now is 6.2. You can see that there are 1,500 people that are unemployed, 24,087 who are employed. And it gives the employment number. The record high was in April of 17.6. The record low was the year before, 2.8, in April of 2019, which means that right now at 6.2%, we still are at a lower rate than we were at the best rates just 4 years ago. And we weren't, you know, as big, you know, it wasn't the big concern we had then. But when you think about that, look at all those people. We got 25,000 people who could be employed, and most of them are. And there are people who are asking for help every day. And I know there might have to be some adjustments that had been made, but sometimes adjustments are good because they change things in our life for the better. The good news is, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. And if I say, the Lord is my helper, what should you say? The Lord is my helper. The Lord is my helper. Say, I'm going to keep saying it till I think you mean it. The Lord is my helper. Amen. Amen. Thank you for helping me believe in that. But see, the devil, he wants to use those schemes of jobs and things like that So we just feel like we're always debilitated. There's nothing we're going to be able to do. Now, I know that in some cases, perception does become reality for people. And those people that perception has become reality, they're the ones who are on the side of the road that have been beaten, exposed, and left for dead. They've been robbed. They've been robbed of their dignity. They've been robbed of their hope. They've been robbed of the truth. And that's why Diane Langberg says it's important for us in the church to be there to encourage them, to help them through. We need to help them through immediately. We need to talk them through it. And then we need to get them the care that they need if it's more complex so that they become completely healed. And our goal here is to help people with the wisdom of God as we heal people with the touch of Christ. As they come in personal contact with Him, they are changed. Now, this pandemic has messed with our fundamental sense of safety and security as we have fallen victim to the lies, exploitations, and embellishments of a godless culture amplified by secular media. And I could spend a week talking to you about this part of it. But just know that everything you see on television, if it's on the news, on cable channel, mainstream media, legacy media, CBS, ABC, NBC, when you see those things, and if it is trying to promote fear in you on any level, then you see it for what it is. It is the devil trying to work through all these people and all these and all these outlets to try to get you to be afraid. Because when you live in fear, you become his puppet. You stop living life, you stop loving life. People we know have allowed the fear of others to infect them, so they are easily manipulated by claims of science. And we're told, we've got to follow the science, we've got to follow the medicine. And charges of selfishness. We're told, you can't be selfish. You can't say that I'm not going to do this or that because I have freedom. And calls of sacrifice. You can't say, well, I'm not going to do that because you need to sacrifice that for everybody else. These things in themselves may not be harmful, but when they're used, wrapped by fear, they become deathly. They undermine the integrity of relationship and culture. So don't be manipulated. Because all these things are offered to us in the name of greater good. But only God knows what good is greater. And that's why He offers us freedom, fulfillment, the funding to live a joyful life as we anticipate our eternal life, no matter what's going on in the culture around us. That's why our Touchpoint Initiative is so important. You, each of you, is a touchpoint for our church and for God in the lives of those people that you know. No matter how old you are or how young you are, you can help people who are afraid. And the best thing we can do to help people who are suffering because of fear is to talk to them about renewing God as a stronghold in their lives. Because when God is our stronghold, whom shall I fear? We're getting a great preview of what America will be like if godless socialism takes root, because fear will always be used in that environment to control people. And the first thing they'll come after is the church to silence us. So we need to use our influence to relieve those who are in fear. We need to use our voices and our vote to proclaim our confidence in what God would have us have confidence in. He's blessed us to live in one of the greatest nations that has ever existed, and we must do everything that we can to be strong and be bold, but we cannot do that if we're living in fear of death or disease or debilitation. You're walking down the road, You're just on your way to do other things, and you find someone hurting there. They're afraid. They've been told lies for months, so they're so afraid that they might die, so afraid that they're going to catch this bug. They're so afraid that they're going to lose their jobs and their means of life. How can you minister to them? How can you help them overcome that fear? Give them the confidence through the truth. Give them courage through the truth. And give them comfort. And God will use you as good Samaritan to bring healing to them. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this opportunity to learn or be reminded of what your word teaches us about fear and what the source of that fear is and how we can overcome our fear through Christ. Lord, I know there are people in our lives who are hurting. We will find them by the side of the road this week. They may be so afraid of death that they just cannot live their lives. They're so afraid of catching this disease or some other that they're afraid to live, get out there and be what you need them to be. And more importantly, they're just afraid that they're not even going to be able to survive this in this life, that everything's going to be lost. Lord, help us to be the good Samaritans who see those who are struggling with these fears and bring them healing through your Son, Christ. Give us the words, the wisdom, and the opportunities to do so this week. I pray this in Jesus' precious name. And let all God's people say.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for thee, and him as thy matchless king through all eternity.